Join our service every Sunday at 10 a.m. as we connect with the Word of God. See you Sunday, and to God be the glory. My sisters and brothers, all in faith and in struggle, good morning. And welcome to the virtual services of the Abyssinian Baptist Church, located in Harlem, New York. Since 1808, this congregation has served God and humanity. We thank you for joining us today as we worship the God of our weary years and of our silent tears. And now, as we invoke the Spirit of God, let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples when he taught them to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now we will hear a selection, Come Down Angels, from our choir. Amen.
Abyssinian, it's prayer time. And as we prepare our hearts and minds to go to the Lord in prayer, we remember the names of those in our faith community who are sick and bereaved. We ask that you would continue to pray for Sister Ethel Calhoun in the passing of her mother. And remember in prayer our webmaster and co-leader of the Archives and History Ministry, Sister Sharon King, in the recent transition of her brother, Ray Butts. We continue to pray for one of Abyssinian's most spirited soloists, Sister Shirley Braun. Sister Braun needs your fervent prayers. We also continue to pray for Sister Alma Nugent, who's in Bellevue Hospital for observation. Sister Augusta Grubb, who remains in the Harlem Hospital for treatment of COVID-19. as well as Brother Ron Whitehurst, who's also in Bellevue Hospital. Sister Venus Harris has been released from the hospital, and we are praying for her full recovery. You will also see on the screen, pre and post service, our prayer requests and our sick and shut-in lists. The names are many, and we ask that you would keep them in prayer. The viewing for our daytime receptionist, John Chapman, will take place today at the International Funeral Chapel, located at 1761 Amsterdam Avenue and 147th Street. The viewing will take place from 2 to 5 p.m. We'd also like to announce the passing of Sister Joanne Roberts, who was the former superintendent of the Abyssinian Sunday School. She passed away on last week, and her services will be held here on Wednesday, February 24th at 11 a.m. And the beloved former leader of the Maddie Fletcher Powell Satellite Laurel B. Thomas Ministry, Sister Ernestine Stroud, also transitioned last week, and we will celebrate her life here at Abyssinian on Friday, February 26th at 11 a.m. Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, the one who is our mother, and the one who is our father, to the God who is our divine caretaker, and the one who is our holy physician. We come in this moment of sacred communication, asking that you would meet us at the point of our needs. God, we ask that you would bring to us a sense of peace and divine comfort. God, we ask that you would touch, heal, and restore all of those whose names have been lifted up on this morning. And God, as we pray for divine healing, God, we ask that you would touch those of us whose names do not appear on the sick and shut-in list. God, we may not be dealing with a physical illness, but God, we may be faced with an illness of another kind. So God, in this moment, we ask that in this time of a much needed healing, that you would be near to us in our time of weakness, that you would heal us according to thy will, and that you would comfort us according to our individual need. God, we ask that you would sustain us by your grace, so that our courage and our strength may not fail. And God, we know that you can do all things well. So in this moment where we need you the most, we'd ask that you would incline thine ear to hear the prayers and petitions of this your servant, and that you would bestow upon us a divine sense of peace, a divine sense of eternal comfort, and a divine sense of wholeness and restoration. This is our prayer in the mighty name of Jesus. And everyone in the church said amen.
To bear. Thank you, Brandy. Brandy Sutton. Let us keep all of our members in prayer. I want to add to that reciting of some names, the name of Deacon Larry Dayes. Deacon Dayes had open heart surgery last week, and I want to let you know that he desires the prayers of the congregation. Let's keep him and his family in our prayers. And now, beloved, I want you to pay attention to two clips that will come up for your viewing. One is from the United States Senate Majority Leader Charles Schumer, who sent us an important message about COVID-19 relief, and as it relates especially to houses of worship and members of our community. As you know, Abyssinian, we've been at the forefront of efforts of distributing the COVID-19 vaccine and testing. You know that I'm working with a consortium of ministers across the nation through an organization called Choose Healthy Life, one that I co-chair with Reverend Sharpton. And we're working together to help many of us get tested. We need to get tested still and vaccinated. And so we have hosted a number of vaccination distributions here in the community, not just for our membership, but the entire community. So let us hear now a message from Senator Charles Schumer. Following that, I'll return to introduce our second message, which comes to us from a very important organization undergirded by our church. Amen.
Hi, everybody. This is Senator Chuck Schumer, and I want to again thank my longtime friend, the Reverend Dr. Calvin Butts, for inviting me to bring a short greeting to all of you, the incredible congregation of the Abyssinian Baptist Church. Dr. Butts has done so much for this church, for our community, for our state, our city, our nation, and our world. He is a blessing to Abyssinian Baptist, and a blessing to the entire country. Over the last 12 months, his ministry and his leadership have been so needed in our community. And I'm just thankful for his friendship and his powerful example. May God give him strength to continue in his ministry. My brothers and sisters, this has been a hard time for our city, our nation, our families, and ourselves. The worst public health calamity since the Spanish flu pandemic 100 years ago. The worst economic crisis since the Great Depression, 75 years ago. And last month, a bunch of radicals, white supremacists, racists, bigots, extremists, and disgusting people assaulted the U.S. Capitol. I was 20 feet away from those extremists when a Capitol police officer pulled me away from danger. But mark my words, our country will not be intimidated or weakened by these domestic terrorists. Last month, thank God, we finally celebrated the inauguration of President Joe Biden, Vice President Kamala Harris, In the Senate, we sat John Ossoff, protege of the late Congressman John Lewis, and Reverend Raphael Warnock, Lewis's former pastor, the first black senator from Georgia, and born while Georgia was still represented by two staunch arch segregationists. I worked hard to recruit Raphael Warnock when Stacey Abrams said she wouldn't run, and he'll be a great senator, as will Ossoff. And, of course, along with them, the Senate turned to Democratic control under the first majority leader from New York State. Guess who that might be? I'm the son of an exterminator and a homemaker, descended directly from victims of the Holocaust. So I promise you, I will fight for each and every one of you every day I serve as majority leader. We'll hit the ground running to finally get this pandemic under control. We got a good head start last month by passing nearly $1 trillion in COVID relief. The bill provided hundreds of billions for working families, stimulus checks, enhanced unemployment insurance, rental assistance, SNAP to feed the hungry, and help for our small businesses, our schools, and the MTA, making sure buses and subways continue to run. I made sure New York benefited substantially from this proposal. We also lifted the Pell Grant eligibility for the incarcerated, so prisoners can study college courses paid for by Pell Grants. When they're in prison and want to make a better life for themselves, if they are making no money, how are they going to afford even community college? Now the Pell Grant will pay for that, so when they leave prison, they can be productive citizens. And I'm especially proud that I was able to make religious institutions, churches like yours, eligible for more PPP funding. I met early with some of the leaders of the Baptist and AME churches, as well as Reverend Sharpton, who told me how much the churches were suffering. No services meant no people showing up, meant no collection plates being filled. The money I fought for will pay for things like the pastor's salary, church employees' salaries, rent, utilities, insurance, and other expenses, a vital lifeline until congregations return in full. Churches are the cornerstones of our neighborhoods. Churches feed the hungry, shelter the homeless, help the elderly and the young, and of course, bring the word of God to the people, which is so even more important now than ever before. That's why I worked so hard to get this provision in the bill, and I hope your church will be able to benefit. If you need some help, feel free to call me and my office, and we will help guide you through the process. It's not a difficult one, and we hope most churches will be able to get the money. I also promise we're going to do more in the weeks and months ahead, including increasing the stimulus checks for families from $600 up to $2,000. I promise we will get through this crisis together. Now, Lord knows, this past year has tested my faith, and I'm sure yours too. But if the scripture teaches us anything, it's that if you're willing to trust fully in God, then a brighter day, joy, will come in the morning. If we continue to have faith in this great country of ours, if we continue to have faith in ourselves, in our neighbors, in our congregations, and most of all in God Almighty, then I believe we will bend that arc of the moral universe that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. spoke about, bend it further in the direction of justice, and maybe one day, finally achieve his dream of a nation where every single one of us has an equal opportunity to prosper and to be respected. That will be our mission in 2021, and I will stand with all of you every step of the way. So God bless all of you. God bless my dear friend, the Reverend Dr. Calvin Butts. God bless Abyssinian Baptist, and God bless these United States of America.
Thank you, Senator Schumer. Thank you for being with us today, and we receive your message with great enthusiasm for the future. And now, beloved, approximately 27 years ago, here at the Abyssinian Baptist Church, a program was established for our young women and men, and it was entitled Blue Nile. Blue Nile is 27 years old, and we're bringing you a special tribute from them to you and in celebration of their continuing success in our community. Blue Nile continues to need elders to work with our young men and women. It is one of the most effective programs that we have, and it is part of the extensive ministry of the Abyssinian Baptist Church. Let us hear now from Blue Nile.
I am!
I am!
Sisters and brothers all, let us congratulate the Blue Nile program for 27 years of work and witness and transformation of young men and women throughout Harlem and New York City. We sing praises to you for all that you have done and will continue to do in our community. And now here are some additional announcements for your consideration on this morning. The Abyssinian Institute for Christian Education is going to be having a season of Lent, a spiritual breakthrough by entering a period of prayer and fasting. Scriptures will be used to strengthen your witness of Christ in your life, and prayer starters have been placed on the homepage of the Abyssinian website. It started this past Wednesday, February the 17th. In addition, the Abyssinian Institute for Christian Education will offer a course during the season of Lent titled, O Jesus, a Lenten Study of Jesus the Christ. This four-week digital course, facilitated by our very own Dr. Ebony Marshall Terman, surveys the birth, life, ministry, death, and resurrection of Jesus while posing this very important question: who is Jesus Christ for us today? And so we invite all to participate in this series starting Wednesday evening. It starts on March the 17th and runs through April the 7th. March 17th through April the 7th. You can see on the screen for more information or go to abyssinian.org. The Women's Ministry has unveiled its programming plans for the 2021 Women's Week. This year's theme is based on prayer, highlighting the scripture, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and by petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Women's Week kicks off Monday, March the 8th, and runs through the celebration of the 68th Annual Women's Day on Sunday, March 14th. You don't want to miss any of the speakers, who include Dr. Carrie Day, who will be with us for the evening of Christian education and the all-female worship service on Monday, March the 8th, and Tuesday, March 9th. Pastor Gabby Wilkes is with us for the three-night revival, which will begin on Wednesday, March 10th through Friday, March the 12th. And Dr. Kimberly Credit comes to us on the morning of Sunday, March 14th as our Women's Day guest preacher. So you can go to abyssinian.org for further information regarding this year's Women's Day. And the men's ministry, on the heels of the women's ministry's program, on Tuesday, March 16th at 7 p.m., will present a real talk series on the topic, love and COVID. How are you doing? You can see below for more detailed information. And again, you can go to abyssinian.org. And here is a very important update, sisters and brothers, with regard to the Abyssinian Federal Credit Union and the scholarship that it is offering to college freshmen. It will reward a $500 scholarship to a college freshman in the 2021 semester. The applicant must submit an essay describing how they have been impacted and affected by the COVID pandemic, and the college freshman or relative of their immediate family must be a member of the Abyssinian Credit Union. This could be a family member, the college applicant, a grandparent, sister and brother, aunt, or uncle. In addition to that, we also want to encourage you at this time, sisters and brothers, all encouraging you to support the ministry of Jesus Christ through giving, so Abyssinian can continue to do its ministry. We give because God has been good. We give because everything we have comes from God. And we want to continue to love our neighbor. We want to continue to provide food for the hungry and clothing for the naked. So we encourage you now, sisters and brothers, to give freely and openly as God has given to us. And finally, this afternoon at 1 p.m., the Abbey Cafe Brunch, hosted by the Joshua Ministry, will take place this afternoon at 1 p.m. We encourage you to get dressed up for this virtual brunch. Join after the church conversation and fellowship for that the soul craves. Remember, sisters and brothers, if you have not already done so, register to participate in this week's brunch. And you can see details below on the screen for more information. And now, sisters and brothers all, we will invite Dr. Butts, our pastor, to come back with his announcements, more announcements, and of course, the scripture for the morning. God bless you.
Thank you, beloved. I just simply want to encourage you to focus your attention on our website, abyssinian.org, to keep up with the announcements that were shared with you. I want to salute and congratulate Blue Nile, and I want to remind all of our members who continue to be terribly and tremendously supportive to a fault of our ministry. Thank you, because this is what we do, and this is what we have been doing now across many, many years. So thank you for your support. I want to draw your attention now to our scripture for the morning. I want to say, as you find our Old Testament scripture comes from the book of the prophet Jeremiah, the 31st chapter, beginning at the 31st verse. Jeremiah 31, beginning at verse 31. As you turn and find that, I want you to prepare yourselves to receive communion in just a few moments. This is our communion Sunday. We celebrate communion on the third Sunday of each month. And you just get yourselves prepared. The wine and the bread, the water and the bread, the juice and the bread, whatever you have. But it is what's in the heart that is most meaningful as you share in communion with us. Our first text, taken from the Old Testament book of the prophet Jeremiah, beginning at the 31st chapter, the 31st verse, Jeremiah 31, 31 and following. Hear now the word of God. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant, which they broke, though I was a husband to them, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they all shall know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and their sin, and I will remember no more. Thus says the Lord, who gives the sun for a light by day, the ordinances of the moon and the stars for a light by night, who disturbs the sea and its waves roar, the Lord of hosts is his name. If those ordinances depart from before me, says the Lord, then the seed of Israel shall also cease from being a nation before me forever. Thus says the Lord. Beloved, next I want you to turn to the Gospel according to Matthew, the 26th chapter, and I'm going to read from the 27th verse. Matthew 26, beginning at verse 27. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the many for the remission of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." So Jeremiah 31:31. "Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel." And Matthew 26 and 27. "He took the cup. Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the new covenant." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of the word and sanctify it to the good of our souls. Beloved, let us pray together now as we prepare to meditate and explore the word of God together. Amen.
I'd rather have Jesus than Jesus than
Once again, thank you, Brandy Sutton, for lifting us and inspiring us through song and with your beautiful voice. One of the great, gifts that my parents gave to me, and I should expand that and say that it came not only from my parents, but my grandparents, and much from my entire family, was my introduction to God through Jesus. A most powerful gift, if you will, that has stayed with me through my entire life. And dearly beloved, it is because of Jesus and the teachings of Jesus that I have been able to navigate the living of these days. Through this COVID-19 pandemic, certainly, I have held to God's unchanging hand, and it has been a source of great comfort for me. It has been a source of stability, and it has taken me more out of the darkness and more into the light, and I'm thankful. And I want to say to you that as we prepare to come to communion today, when we remember this do in remembrance of Jesus, when we remember the life and death and resurrection of Jesus, I want you to focus on something that Jesus shared with his disciples around the Passover table. He said, in recognition of his pending death, "This is my blood of the New Testament, the New Covenant, which is shed for the many for the remission of sin. But I say unto you that I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Jesus was a young rabbi. He did not have his own words to refer to, nor did he have the writings of the Apostle Paul to turn to. Jesus was a rabbi. He was Jewish. And when he wanted to reflect on the scripture, he had to go
to what we call today primarily the Old Testament, the books of the law and the prophets. And so when Jesus made a reference to the new covenant, our first text this morning from Jeremiah has Jeremiah saying that there will be, taking his word from God, a new covenant that he will establish with Israel. Now, it's important to remember that the prophets were speaking on behalf of the nation of Israel, of the people of Israel. And the old covenant had been established at Sinai. And if you want reference to that old covenant, go back to Exodus 19 and follow that all the way through chapter 24, 25. And that old covenant laid down a law. It laid down a way of life. It laid down a way that if the nation of Israel was going to grow stronger during its sojourn in the wilderness and beyond, it had to follow the law, the commandments, the teachings of Almighty God. And so, beloved, when Jesus refers to the new covenant, he is talking about something that he perhaps read or understood divinely. And I point to Jeremiah because Jeremiah explains in that little short verse the new covenant. He said that Israel, the people of Israel, had trespassed on the old covenant, that they had been unfaithful to God, that they had not obeyed God. Trust and obey, there's no other way. That they had not obeyed God. That they had not kept the faith with God. And therefore, God had withdrawn from them. God had withdrawn from them. And in Jeremiah, it talks about how God had been a husband to Israel. A husband. And I would dare say that you would go to the prophet Hosea and look how Hosea had been a good husband to Gomer, his wife, who had been unfaithful. And so God had been faithful to Israel in face of her unfaithfulness to God. And so God says, I'm going to establish a new covenant. You couldn't keep the old one. Therefore, I'm going to establish a new covenant where the law and commandments of God would be written on not stone, but in your minds and on your heart. Look at this, beloved. And Jesus, I believe, refers to this new covenant when he says, this is my blood of the new covenant, shed not just for Israel, but shed for the many. Oh, glory to God. Not just for Israel, shed for the many for the remission of sin. And beloved, I want to suggest to you now that what I'm preaching to you about this morning is not a message that is just narrowly defined by one people or one group. This is a message that is for all. It's the gospel of Jesus. And it's a gospel that reaches out to the entire world. I don't care who you are, where you've come from, what you've done before. The Lord is looking for you. The same way that Hosea looked for Gomer. Don't care where you've been, what you've done. Come on home because I'm here to receive you. And for those of you from the old rhythm and blues days, it's almost like by the time I get to Phoenix, had been cheating, had been unfaithful, but every time they came back home, there was someone to receive them. But I want to remind you that grace does run out. I want you to know, beloved, that the Lord God is looking for you. I don't care who you are that's listening to me this morning or watching us on the live stream. The Lord is looking for you. God wants you to be, to return unto God, to return unto God, to put aside your sinful ways and to come back home. And so Jesus, referring to Jeremiah, says, this is my blood because I'm going to the cross for you. I'm going to show you what it means to be faithful and obedient unto God, even unto death on a cross.
That's why God has given him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee would bow and every tongue would confess, because the Lord God has anointed our Christ to go to the cross for us. And beloved, it's a way of telling us what a commitment truly is. I want to say unto you that we see Dr. King, and I can't help but refer to him all the time. Talk about how longevity has its place, but it didn't matter because he'd been to the mountaintop. He'd looked over and seen the promised land, and I keep saying to you, what did he see? He must have saw something so beautiful, something so inspiring, something so magnificent, that he was willing to give up his earthly life, his sojourn with us. He had a dream, beloved, that one day, and he outlined what that dream meant. He talked about how justice would roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. He talked about that dream, how black and white would join together in a new community, a beloved community. And he was willing to give his life for it, as was Jesus. Jesus understood what he was doing when he sat down with his disciples. He wanted them to know, this is my body that has been broken for you, and this is my blood, and I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine. Martin King said it as clearly. He said, I saw the promised land. I will not get there with you. But then Jesus said, but I will drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. And Martin King said, we will get there as a people to the promised land. Oh, beloved, it's as clear as a crystal to me. It's clear that we all have to live and trust and, most importantly, obey the word of God. We cannot back up on our standards. We cannot back up and go with the world on what the world believes. We must stand firmly on the word of God, even if it takes us to a cross. We're not out here to be popular. We're not out here to build numbers. We're out here to preach the gospel of Jesus. Those who have ears, let them hear. Jeremiah was laying out the word of God. And beloved, while we fight for social justice, while we demand that men and women live according to the law of this land and that it is spread equally, we do not compromise as politicians do. We stand firm on what we believe. And that's what makes the church militant so dangerous to this world. Jesus told us over and over again, separate yourself from this crooked and perverse generation. And only men and women of God who dare to stand up for Jesus understand what the sacrifice might be. And so, beloved, when you come to the table today, when you eat of his broken body and drink of his shed blood, I want you to remember this is a new covenant, not just for Israel, but for all. I want you to remember this is a covenant that was brought to us by the Lamb of God, whose sacrifice saves us. It is by us, beloved, and by the preaching of this word, and by the embrace. Remember the cross. It's a horizontal against a vertical. It's the upward look and the downward look. It's the upward look of the creature to the creator and the downward look of the creator to the creature. It's the love that goes up and down. And it's the horizontal, beloved. It is the embrace. It is the open arms of Jesus that's reaching out for you. And I don't care what drug you're on. I don't care if it's marijuana or heroin or cocaine. I don't care, or alcohol. I don't care what you're addicted to. I don't know if it's sex. I don't know what it may be. I don't know what's drawing you down, what's sapping your strength. But I'm saying to you, there's a God who loves you. And no matter how unfaithful you may have been, why don't you come on home to God? Why don't you sit at his table? He's inviting you. Judas was there. Peter was there. Thomas was there. All sinners before God. But God loved them and embraced them the same way Hosea would welcome Gomer back home. Oh, beloved, it's time to come home. I'm pleading with you. If you want to save a United States of America, if you want to redeem the black community, come on home to God. My blood of the New Testament, my body broken for you. Whatever it is, come to the table. Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters. He that hath no money, come ye buy and eat. It's free, beloved. You just have to give your heart to God. It's the power of God. Not by power. It's important. Not by might. Somebody better know how to fight. But by the word of God. That's the salvation. And so I offer it to you today. I'm pleading with you. Hear it. Young and old. It's available to you. It's difficult for many of us. We're all sinners. But remember, there's something called grace. My grace is sufficient. It's amazing. It saved a wretch like me, and it's available to you. But don't play with God, because grace runs out. I teased you with that little song. You know the title was "By the Time I Get to Phoenix." That was Isaac Hayes a long time ago. But he did leave, finally. He did leave. Don't play with God. Grace does run out. So come on home. Be a part of us. Join with us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Eternal God, bless us now as we go down to the communion table. We ask of you that our brothers and sisters who are listening today would find their peace through Jesus. In the God of all the worlds. We thank you for this moment of prayer, and we ask, O God, that you would continue to be with us through every day or all the way. And so, hear our prayers. We're asking for forgiveness, O God. Lead us and guide us on the way home. We're thanking you, O God, for all the blessings we've received already. We're just grateful and happy today because you are our God and we are your children. Bless the Abyssinian Church and its ministry, O God. Help us to keep our doors open and our light shining that men and women might find their way to you. And be gracious to our young, O God. Many of them are just beginning to discover what it means to know a God who loves them. And who looks beyond all of our faults and sees our needs. And so, dear God, have mercy today and bless us. And now we ask that the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts will be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. You hear our brother Braxton playing gently. Amazing grace. We're going down to the communion table now. I hope that you are prepared to receive communion with us. And we thank God for you. Amen. Our authority for our communion service is found in the 26th chapter of the Gospel according to Matthew. The lesson begins at the 17th verse. Now on the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus asking of him, "Master, where wilt thou that we prepare for thee to eat the Passover?" And he said unto them, "Go into the city to such a man, and say unto him that the master saith, My time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at thy house with my disciples. And the disciples did as Jesus had appointed them, and they made ready the Passover. And now when the evening was come, he sat down with the 12. Are there any words for Jesus? One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. As they were eating, Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto you that one of you will betray me. And every one of them became exceedingly sorrowful and began to ask him, Lord, is it I? And Jesus said, the one who dips his hand with me in the dish shall betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe unto that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been good for that man if he had not been born. Then Judas, who betrayed him, answered and said, Master, is it I? Jesus looked at him and responded, thou hast said. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Lord, as these words go out across this medium, may our sisters and brothers at home and in places near and far gather their loved ones around them, and if they are alone, O God, put their hand in your hand and ask now that you would give them the strength to look within and pose the question, Lord, is it I? Have I betrayed you in some way? Have I failed you? Have I left undone some deed that needs to be attended to? Dear God, come into our church and ask us as a church, or let us ask ourselves as a church, have we betrayed our God? Have we been lukewarm? Have we not represented the true call of God through Jesus? Right now, Lord, we're not looking at my mother and my father, my brother, my sister. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. So, dear God, have mercy today. And help us to restore ourselves through your grace. Help us to come home to God. Help us to know the righteousness of God. Help us to obey the teachings and commandments of God that we might be drawn closer to you, O God. That we might be saved from the ravages of this world. Lord, is it I? Remember, thou hast said, amen. And he took the bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, eat ye all of it, for this is my body. Lord, bless now this bread. Transform it from its common use to its spiritual use, that we might be fed by manna from on high. Bread of heaven, feed us till we want no more. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ broken for you, eat ye all of it. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, thank you. We light these candles to signify the life of Jesus. Jesus is the light of the world. And he told us from his Sermon on the Mount that we are the lights of the world, and that we should let our light shine so that others will see our good works and give glory to our God. Jesus, the light of the world. We walk in the light. It's a beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Shine all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the light of the world. And he took the cup, and he gave thanks, and he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for the many for the remission of sin. But I say unto you that I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Let us pray. Lord, change the contents of this cup from the secular use to the sacred purpose, the blood of Jesus. We drink now, O God, remembering the awesome sacrifice of a young man who gave all that he had because he knew of the kingdom. He assured us that in our Father's house are many mansions, that he was going to prepare a place for us. And Lord, we believe, we trust the word of our big brother. And we dedicate our lives to the cause of the gospel, the good news. So Lord, we let our light shine. Sometimes people laugh at us because they think we're foolish. Sometimes they don't understand us because we do things contrary to the world. Sometimes they hate us because we stand firmly on the word of God. And that word does not change unless we are instructed by the Holy Spirit. So, dear God, as we taste of this blood, we remember that our brother believed so deeply that he gave his life. Nobody took it from him. He gave it up. He knew what was demanded. So, Lord, help us to commit ourselves now as we take of this cup. Hear us as we pray now. In the name of Jesus, amen. And he took the cup and he said, "This is my blood of the New Testament, shed for the many for the remission of sin. Drink ye all of it." There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath its flood lose all their guilty stains. Dearly beloved, let us recommit ourselves today to the cause of Jesus, to the gospel of Jesus. Let us go forth from this service renewed and changed, if you will, so that we will walk according to God's commandments. There is something required of us. Salvation is free, but the Lord asks of us, his friends. He says, "You are my friends if you do my commandments." So let us love one another. Let us work for justice and peace on this earth. Help us, O God, to open our arms to all. Help us to be a friend to humankind. We thank you, Lord, for your blessings today, and we ask your peace upon our service. And it was night. And when they had sung an hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. Beloved, we ask you again to remember our ministries here at the Abyssinian Church. We want you to know that what you give supports our work. You saw the beautiful salute of the Blue Nile Passage, girls and boys, and we thank you so much for your support of that ministry. But I want you to remember the ministry to our seniors in our Golden Life ministry, helping them to navigate not only through this difficult time of COVID-19, but also being there in the process of simply getting older, improving your vision, helping with your hearing, knowing how to use transportation services here in the city. We thank you, O God, for our health ministry, responsible for seeing that we get the COVID-19 here. We were the leaders here. We thank you, O God, for what they've done in testing. And we've joined up with other churches across the nation, in Atlanta, in Detroit, in Washington, D.C., in Newark, New Jersey, and right here in New York. We thank you, O God, for all of our ministries, our scholarship ministry that continues to support students with scholarships across this nation, and the ministry only grows more robust. The family of Sister Cicely Tyson has pledged that they too will support our scholarship ministry. Beloved, we are doing great work. Our Christian education, we are offering these courses for Lent. Our Bible class continues to grow stronger on Monday and Wednesday, and our prayer line is there for you continually. Our food pantry, just yesterday we served nearly 200 families just in a pop-up. So we have the food, we have the support. I don't know what else to do but to just tell you these things. And it's not like we've just been doing them in the last 15 years. These are ministries that have been going on for decades, for centuries, over two. So Abyssinian is strong because of you. And I ask you to remember the Zelle. I ask you to remember text to give. You may mail your contributions to the church. Thank you from all across the nation. And Deacon McShay, I hope you're watching us today. This is our senior deacon. He lives down in Delaware, Maryland, somewhere down there. And he usually drives up. We love you, Deacon McShay. We remember you and we thank you for all that you do. And Lassiter down there in Florida, we thank you for all you do. I mentioned Lassiter because he went to Howard University, and you know, I have to be kind to Howard because I got a lot of Howard people here in the church. And I always mention these historically black colleges and universities because they are very important to us and who we are. So to all of them, and Rashad Hoggett is looking at me, so North Carolina A&T too. All of you out there, Knoxville, I don't know, I got a Knoxville graduate looking at me back there, and I've got you from all over. So I want you to know that we support you, and education, wherever you get it from, is key, is key. So thank you, beloved. God bless you. May this communion service live with you until we meet again around this table. And now may the power of God, the love of Christ Jesus, and the communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us all now, henceforth, and forevermore, world without end. Amen.
There are times we stand alone.